Hello everyone and welcome back to Simulating Fluid Flows Using Python course. In the lecture today, we are actually going to talk about the Python script that is going to solve the one-dimensional heat conduction problem. Hopefully, some of you have given it a try. If you are facing bugs, that is totally fine because in the lecture today, you would be able to see what you were actually doing wrong. So in the previous lecture, we had looked over all the necessary commands, functions, statements that I would be using today. So I would be walking you through the script and maybe then you can pick up as to where you were doing wrong. So without wasting any further time, let's get started. So recall from the last lecture, we had this particular slide where I was trying to put things together. And in the first part here, we had this initialize variable section. So in the code that I want to write, first of all, before anything else, before any computations, I want to initialize all the variables. So if I go to my Python script here, so of course my Python script would start by getting the NumPy module. So we first get the NumPy module that would be needed for the calculations, but let's forget about it for a while because we first need to initialize the variables. So just like always, we get the number of grid points, which I'm representing here as capital N. We have a domain size of capital L equals to 1. And remember that based on these two, you can define the grid spacing. So the other way to do this is you can define the grid spacing, you can define the number of points, and based on that, you can have the total domain length. So that is totally up to your choice as to which two variables you want to pick. In this problem, we were given the domain size and we chose the number of points, and that is why the grid spacing was automatically taken care of. After this, I define a variable called as iterations to calculate or to keep a track of my iteration number so that I can see how many iterations would the code need in order to converge. Then I come to defining or rather initializing the temperature field. So remember that this is a one-dimensional problem, so my temperature field would be numerically represented as a temperature array. So we would need some kind of array system to take care of that. So here I'm calling as one variable that is calling as t, and I'm calling as t equals to np dot zeros n. So remember, this is np stands for NumPy, and np dot zeros, when I'm calling np dot zeros, it implies that I'm trying to initialize an array of which all the elements are zero, and in the brackets I specify the size of the array. So because I have n number of grid points, so my array is also n sized array. And thereafter, because we had certain boundary condition for the temperature field, so I'm writing here t of n minus 1 equals to 1. So recall that in Python, the last index of the last boundary point, the index of that point, it corresponds to n minus 1. And this was because the indexing was starting from 0. So in the physical problem, we had this particular point always maintained at a temperature of 1. And that is why in my code, I am defining T, that is the temperature, at n minus 1. So I'm using the large brackets here because that's the convention in Python. And n minus 1 is the index of that point. And I'm simply writing a 1 dot. So the dot here represents that I'm trying to have a floating points array. If I had written it as 1, that would take as an integer value, but I don't really want that because the temperature can take decimal values. So it's a good idea to have that floating point right into the start. Thereafter, I have another array that is called as the T new, which is basically the iterated temperature. So wherever I would update the values of T, that would be stored in T new. And again, I'm simply defining as a zero array at the start and just modifying the boundary point. So basically these two lines here are simply the copied from these two lines over here. And finally, my initialization finishes with initializing the error related variables. So I have an epsilon, that is my target error. So we want the solutions to go up to this particular value. You can have any value that you want or anything that is specified. And then I define another variable called as numerical error. So this variable, it would be used to calculate the numerical error in my numerical scheme. And this epsilon is what we want the numerical error as sort of at the end. So once the numerical error is smaller than this epsilon, then we say the code has been converged. All right, so before I go into the next part, let me recall from the PowerPoint what we had here. So we had the statement called as while the numerical error is greater than epsilon. And this makes sense because we only want to do the calculations if the numerical error is greater than epsilon. So that is why we use the. So the statement that I have written here is while the numerical error is greater than epsilon. So if the numerical error is larger, we have to do the iterations. And our iterations include a for loop at first because we need to iterate for all the points. So here my index I that is inside the for loop or taking care of the for loop, it goes from 1 to n minus 1. And within the for loop, we would have the iterative formula. So again, if I go to my code, inside the for loop, I have the same formula that should be used that says p new at I. So again, in the large brackets here, we have 0.5, that is a representative of half, multiply by ti minus 1 and ti plus 1. So I add them here. So everything that is written in this line or this indented section that is inside this for loop. So after my for loop is done, we have to recalculate the numerical error. So before we recalculate that, it is important that you reset the value of the numerical error to 0. So we had started the numerical error as 1 because we wanted to go inside this while loop. So had you initialized this numerical error from 0, this while loop wouldn't be satisfied and the code wouldn't go inside. So if you had numerical error as 1 and epsilon as 0 point some very small value, then the while loop would be satisfied that the numerical error is larger and then the code would actually run. So before we jump into that, we actually recalculate the numerical error and we reset the numerical error as 0 and then we calculate using the for loop again. So here I'm writing the numerical error is numerical error plus the absolute value of ti minus t nu I. So I'm using the absolute value of the difference between the current iteration and the previous iteration. So you can also do it in a RMS form where you basically square this particular expression, that would also be reasonable. So here, after I calculate the numerical error, so this is the updated value of the numerical error, and this would then be compared with the epsilon before the start of next iteration. So finally, after my iteration has been done, what we do is we simply assign iterations as iterations plus one. So this simply represents that we have done one iterations and the variable iterations, which was previously initialized at 0, that would become 1. And in further iterations, it would go as 2, 3, 4, and so on. And in order to do multiple iterations in future, we have to assign or we have to reassign the value of t in the form of t new. So recall that we should be using the copy command here, which would store or which would copy all the data that is stored in this t new variable and it would feed into this t variable. So now we have gotten a converged solution. So we have done all the calculations and if the code doesn't has any bug, you should be able to get a temperature field that should satisfy your boundary conditions. So you have a temperature field which is one dimensional. So it makes sense that if you want to visualize it using a linear pattern. So we would be using linear plots in order to visualize the results. So recall that for the calculations, you were using the NumPy module. And similarly for the plotting, we have another module that is called as Matplotlib. So in order to implement the matplotlib, again, just like we were getting the NumPy module, we were importing it as np. For the matplotlib module, we import the matplotlib, and within the matplotlib, we are only interested in Python plot. So we write import matplotlib.pyplot and as plt. So here, plt is the synonymous for the Python matplotlib.pyplot. You can use anything that you wish, but plt is something that has been historically used, so I will stick to that. So before we can plot the results, we have to define the position vector of all the grid points. So far we have been dealing in terms of the grid points, but since the domain has the length of 1, we can define the position or the x coordinate of all the grid points, and that is what we are trying to do using this particular command. So we are calling the arrange function from the NumPy, and what that does is it creates a set of equally spaced values, so ranging from 0 to n. So if you have 10 grid points, so it would create a 0 to 10. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. It would create an array equally spaced, that is spaced by 1 and all the way from 0 to n. So this sort of represent our grid. And if we multiply it by h, that is the grid spacing, that would give me the position vector of all the points. So that is what we need in order to plot the temperature profile, because we want to plot the temperature as a function of x. So in order to plot the variation of temperature, we simply use plt, that is the same thing that we had imported, dot plot. So plt dot plot, it can produce a two-dimensional plot that you can further use, or you can customize accordingly to the variables that you want to plot. So here on the x-axis, I want to plot the x-dome, that is the domain, the coordinates of all the points. On the y-axis, I want to plot the temperature. So basically the syntax here says that if we want to plot x and y, we simply write plt.plot, and in the bracket we can put x and y. The things over here that I'm highlighting right now, this is only for the customization. So I'll walk you through that. So here in the single inverted commas, the first letter here corresponds to the color of the line. So here G stands for green, and X over here, it represents the type of the markers. So because this is not a continuous system, for every grid point, we would have a value. So when I want to visualize the result, rather than having a continuous line, what I want to do is I want to mark every point's temperature. So I'm using this cross as a marker, and I'm using a dashed line to fill in between those markers. So that is why these two dashes. Following this syntax, I'm using line width equals to 2. So it represents that the dashed line that would be there, it would have a line width of 2 pixels. And the markers, the cross markers, they have a size of 10. So you would be seeing this, and it would become much more clear once I would run the program. And then I would be displaying the grid lines. So again, this is something that would become clear when we would be running the code. And finally, we would be labeling the axis and providing the titles. So again, note here that we are using the same plt, that is the plotting libraries. We are using that matplotlib libraries in order to do all this customization. So for labeling, it's again a very simple syntax, that accordingly to what the label that you want to produce, you put the X label or Y label accordingly where you want to put it. And you can also define the size of the font. So here I'm using a 20 as the font size. And in the title, I'm sticking with the default font size. So here you can observe, or you can later observe, that the sizes of my labels and the title would be different. And finally, I'm using a command called as plt.show. So this may or may not be needed depending on the compiler. But so far, at least in the case of Spider, I don't really need it. But I have put it just in case if your code doesn't produce any output. So if I right click here and click run cell, that would basically just run this whole script. And in the variable explorer, if I go, I see that the code converges in 336 iterations. So mind you that this is for the case of when I have 11 grid points, and the final numerical error is 10 to the power of minus 9, so which is good. So here, if I maximize my plot, it's very easy to see that we have the temperature versus position, and you can see that the font size here, it's larger than the title that goes here, which is much smaller. So this is the customization that I was talking about. You can change the size, but let's come to the more important part, which is the data visualization. So my domain ranges from 0 to 1, and I have 11 number of grid points. The temperature is plotted or represented using these cross, and between those points, just for the sake of visualization, I have put this dashed line. So remember that this dashed line is not really existent. We only have the temperature at the node points. We don't really produce or we don't really calculate those values in between that. So I've just fitted that dashed line for the sake of visualization. So in this particular way, you can get a two-dimensional plot in which you can have two variables plotted against each other. So hopefully this script would give you an idea of where you were making some mistakes and of course how you can make the plots. In the next lecture is going to be very interesting because we are going to look at general formalization of finite volume methods. Because so far we have sort of tried to convert our FDM approach and FVM approach towards each other, but we were not really looking at finite volume methods independently. So in the next lecture, I would give you a standard and a more general approach to finite volume, and this would be what you would find in all the standard textbooks as well. So stay tuned for the next lecture. If you have any kind of feedback on this lecture or if your code still having some issues, please write them down in the comments and I would try to help you ASAP. Until then, please stay safe and please take care.